Om Namah Shivaya students, today we are going to start with class 11 political science chapter 6 part 3 the judiciary. In the previous session we have learnt about the appointment of the judges of India. Now in this session we will have a discussion about the removal of the judges from their office as well as an unsuccessful attempt to remove a judge and structure of the judiciary of India as well as the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. And this will be followed with the assignment that has to be done in chapter 6 part 3 the judiciary. A removal of the judges. Students, till now we had a discussion that the process for the removal of the judges from their office is known as impeachment. Let us read and understand this in detail. How can the judges of the Supreme Court and High Court are removed? Now, the removal of the judges of the Supreme Court and the High Courts is also extremely difficult. A judge of a Supreme Court or High Court can be removed only on the ground of proven misbehavior or incapacity, that means incapable of carrying out their duties. A motion containing the charges against the judge must be approved by special majority in both houses of the parliament. Do you remember what special majority means? We have studied this in chapter on elections. It is clear from this procedure that removal of the judge is a very difficult procedure or process. And unless there's a general consensus among members of the parliament, a judge cannot be removed. It should also be noted that while in making appointments, the executive plays a crucial role, the legislature has the powers of the removal. This has ensured both balance of power and independence of judiciary. So far, only one case of removal of judge of the Supreme Court came up for consideration before the parliament. In that case, though the motion got two-thirds majority, it did not have the support of the majority of the total strength of the house, and therefore the judge was not removed. Now let us read about this unsuccessful attempt to remove a judge that we have read above. In 1991, the first ever motion to remove a Supreme Court justice was signed by 108 members of the parliament. Justice Ramaswamy, during his tenure as the Chief Justice of the Punjab High Court, was accused of misappropriating funds. In 1992, a year after the parliament had started the impeachment proceedings, a high profile inquiry commission consisting of judges of the Supreme Court found Justice V. Ramaswamy guilty of willful and gross misuse of office and moral turpitude by using public funds for private purposes and reckless disregard of statutory rules. While serving as Chief Justice of Punjab and Haryana, despite this strong indictment, Ramaswamy survived the parliamentary motion recommending removal. The motion recommending his removal got the required two-thirds majority among the members who were present and voting. But the Congress party abstained from voting in the House. Therefore, the motion could not get the support of one half of the total strength of the House. So this resulted in the unsuccessful attempt to remove a judge. Now check your progress. Why is independence of the judiciary important? the independence of the judiciary is important so that the executive and legislature cannot pressurize the judiciary to make unbiased to make biased jurisdiction on any matter, so that the judiciary can impart unbiased jurisdiction for the cases. Do you think that executive should have the power to appoint the judges? If the executive will have the power to appoint the judges, then they can pressurize also the judges to work according to their will. And executive in India, in Indian democracy, is not the permanent authority or permanent body. They are subject to change. So when they change, the others come to power, they might not have the faith in the judges. That is why it is important that executive should not have power to appoint the judges in India. If you were asked to make suggestions for changing the procedure of appointing judges, what changes would you suggest? This is for you to make a illustration that we will discuss once we meet in the class. Now, coming to the structure of the judiciary, the Constitution of India provides for a single integrated judicial system. This means that unlike some other federal countries of the world, India does not have separate state courts. The structure of the judiciary in India is pyramidal, with the Supreme Court at the top, High Court below them, and district and subordinate courts at the lowest level, that we will see in the diagram below. The lower courts function under the direct superintendence of the higher courts. So this is called the structure of the judiciary, or the hierarchy of the judiciary followed in India. Now look at this flowchart representation of the structure of the judiciary of India. Supreme Court is at the topmost, subordinated by the High Court and the District Court and subordinate courts. So both the Supreme Court and the High Court, they have the authority to look at the working of the subordinate courts. Whereas the High Court, under the High Court is the District Court. So this is the hierarchy of the courts in India. Now coming to the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. Jurisdiction means the powers and the area of authority of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court of India is one of the very powerful courts anywhere in the world. However, it functions within the limitations imposed by the Constitution, as the Constitution is the law of the land. The functions and responsibilities of the Supreme Court are defined by the Constitution. The Supreme Court has a specific jurisdiction or scope of powers. Now, this is the flowchart representation of the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court, the area of authority of the Supreme Court. The jurisdiction of the Supreme Court are as follows. Original jurisdiction. Under the original jurisdiction, Supreme Court settles the disputes between the union and the states and amongst the state, as well as number two is the appellate jurisdiction. Under the appellate jurisdiction, the Supreme Court tries appeals from lower courts in civil and criminal and constitutional cases. This is also known as the advisory court. Advises the president on matters of public importance and law. Writ. A writ we have read in the previous chapter can issue writs. That means the Supreme Court can issue writs of habeas corpus, mandamus, prohibition of certiorari and quo warranto to protect the fundamental rights of the individuals. This is according to the fundamental rights and its protection that the writ is issued by the Supreme Court. Now, the special powers of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court can grant a special leave to an appeal from any judgment or matter passed by any court in the territory of India. So, these are the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. Now, the assignment that has to be followed in Chapter 6, Part 3 are as follows. Number 1, name the highest judicial authority in India. Number 2, write down the composition of the Supreme Court of India. Number 3, how can a judge be removed from his office? Number 4, explain the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. So these are the four questions that you need to answer in your fair copy. In the next session, Chapter 6, Part 4, we will continue with the chapter. Om Namah Shivaya.